Any general questions before we get started? So about the homework, there wasn't really a assignment where, I really want to see like everybody's long form raw video or anything like that. The assignment was mostly to get you to have stuff to use over the next couple classes, and also just to get you familiar with the camera. I made that channel on Discord a little bit ago. I would like you to still make a post on Notion. You don't have to post your entire footage or anything like that, but just, screenshot and just kind of generally talk about, how did it go? Lessons learned, that sort of thing. What was difficult? What was easy? But I don't need to see your whole raw footage. But you'll most likely be using that footage for today's assignments and what we talk about in here now. So don't feel pressured to post that today. Just post it when you post this week's assignment as well. Okay. Does that make sense? I should have been more clear about that, I guess. That's like making a formal assignment on the syllabus, because otherwise nobody does it. Like, shoot some footage. No, nobody shot any footage. All right. I am recording. Thank you for the warnings. So today we're talking all about 3D camera tracking. This is our fifth week. We're getting quite close to our kind of big switch in the class where we're moving over to the wall. There's still some bugs that are being ironed out. But I think I foresee like a 50-50 split of people doing what we're doing with green screen, or what you want to do with the wall. Both kind of have some limitations, but I wanted to show you both in this class, and I felt kind of wrong not using the wall at all this semester when it was just sitting over there. And everybody would be like, "Why aren't we using that big thing?" But this is a transitionary semester for this class because we had never used an LED wall before. So that's to come, camera tracking today. So today we start talking about this match motion pipeline. And the pipeline kind of looks like this. So we're using After Effects as our camera tracking software. That camera track is going to be converted from a 2D informational camera track into a three-dimensional camera using Cinema, Maya. You might be able to use Blender, although I'm not super familiar with that, to convert the camera into 3D, which we can then import as an FBX file, which is a standard 3D file, back into Unreal. At the end of this process, we are going to have a 3D representation of our camera movement that we do, whether it's on green screen or shot outside. We're going to have what we're doing with After Effects today with the 3D camera tracking. We're extracting that camera movement from the video file that we shot, turning it into a 3D file, and then bringing it back into Unreal. And in Unreal, when we look at it next week, you will open up Sequencer, import that camera, and see all the keyframes for the movement that you did either on green screen or in the real world. We're using Unreal as a filmmaking tool for previs, making cool videos, virtual production. And I want to get you start to think about, how can we start to incorporate CG into these scenes? After Effects, it's not really a world-building tool. We will pop up a few 3D grids in After Effects today to show you this effect, but we're using Unreal for our world-building. We will come back to After Effects, I think in 2 weeks, when we start to do some a little bit more advanced compositing. Because at this point, we've been able to shoot on green screen or in the real world, key that out as we looked at, I think that was 2 weeks ago, and last week a little bit as well. And now we're going to be able to track that camera, bring it into Unreal, export that camera movement with the foregrounds and backgrounds, bring all of that stuff back into After Effects or whatever your compositing tool is, Resolve, Fusion, Nuke, After Effects, whatever, and put it all back together for a final composite. Now I want to show you some examples of, I think all of these examples of my own, from some newer, some older, just to kind of show you what's possible. So the simplest thing we can do, and we kind of demoed this last week on that big old tripod with that big old camera, is to just completely lock off the camera. When I say lock off the camera, I just mean not moving it. We're not moving the tripod, we're not shifting the pan, tilt head, or anything like that. If we're hand-holding the camera, you can't really have a locked off camera when you're hand-holding it. It's just frozen, not moving. Whenever we move the camera, it makes things very, very difficult with VFX, because the whole goal with this process that we call match motion is sticking those graphics to the surface of either the green screen or in the real world and making them not look like they're floating around, making them look like when the camera moves this way, the graphic moves that way. Any sort of camera shake, that also happens in the visual effect. If we don't move the camera, it's a lot easier. This is a very old project of mine. This was actually the first larger scale video I ever made in Unreal Engine 3, kind of demoing whether or not we could use gaming engines to make films. It was called Brave New World because it kind of was the possibility of a Brave New World. Flash forward today and it worked out. But this example, kind of talk over it. This example just puts flat planes of video into the environment. The biggest and best it has limitations with perspective, but as long as you line the camera up,
Brave New World.
You will kind of see
some of your all-time favorites, plus astonishing new faces, like Peggy here, who will make you feel like a kid again, right down to the popcorn. Can I get a taste of that, sweetheart? What a gal. A spectacle of excessive imagination, electrifying performers, and death divine
environment. We put video on them. If we go around the edge of the plane,
you will see Joan the Mermaid with her beautiful golden tail. She's bewitched many men to his death in the waters. Be careful, guys. Next, we have the tragic case of the girl who's trapped in the bottle, doomed to eternity with a cork because her atmosphere is not the air that you breathe.
This was what Unreal Engine 3 about 2000.
In our state-of-the-art facility, you will see our professional performers and... Excuse me, guys, we seem to have caught you on your break. Brave New World is the brainchild of the demented genius Zadie Carlyle III. His shows have been banned in 8 states, so get in while you still can. Don't miss John Phenomenon, the incredible knife-throwing clown. They say he was born with knives for hands, and his mother never let him forget it.
As the camera flies over, it's supposed to show
the mistress of Brave New World is unmissable. Known only as the Lady in Black, she has the elemental forces at her control.
That should be possible if the camera's locked off. Kind of a trick to make that work. But you have any ideas how would you hack
forces at her control? Brave New World is unmissable. Known only as the Lady in Black, she has the elemental forces at her control.
Any guesses? The camera's not moving. What if we just had her turn? So she's just standing on a turntable and just kind of rotate it and eventually make the camera move at the same rate and fudge it together. Nobody knows. In reality, it would be great if you had a big green screen space and you could have a camera on a big boom or a track and move it around and actually physically move the camera. But, you know, there's no budget for that back then. So, gotta fake it.
We've got cotton candy. This is the land you've dreamed of. Right, Sammy? And for the old folks, we have Miss Electra Jones, who stabbed her fiancé twice in the eye and now sits in the electric chair six times daily. Telepathic tin triplets know your deepest, darkest secrets, but don't worry, they won't tell for a price. And finally, the Lady Raven. Her perverse love of heights is our game. Watch as she teeters 50 feet above the ground. She's convinced that she can fly, and we're crossing our fingers and getting out the mops. Brave New World is the hottest ticket in town. Get togged to the bricks, grab the Rugrats, and let's have a ball.
Video project I ever did with Unreal. Didn't really know anything about camera tracking or even Unreal for that much. Back then, at least Unreal Engine 3. Behind the scenes here, shot on green screen. No tracking marks because the camera's locked off. Oh, a spinner. The poor assistant spinning. I've been in that position, spinning the people. That's a good, that's me. That's a good look for me right there. That's my wife, Pamela, too. She's a clown. Another example here. I got a lot of examples. So in this, the camera actually, does move just on a dolly, really quick rotational shot. It's also Unreal Engine 3. Just thought this felt really immersive because of the foreground elements sliding against the background. You know, some of the leaves cover her up, especially down bottom. That little bit makes it feel like she's encapsulated in the leaves rather than just on top of them. Oh, that was in the beginning. Shot on green screen. Here's the behind the scenes of that. Very simple scene. In Unreal Editor. It's called Pizza Dad. This is also me. These are my three children. Where's the speaker? Locked off camera as well. The little bit of camera shake is just added in Unreal and post. You can get away with a little camera movement like that without having it look fake with the perspective. Yeah. What do you mean? So let me break it down. So I got my three children and we went to a playground and we filmed this. No, it was shot on green screen. Actually, this was the little storyboard for it. Right here. There's supposed to be snowmen. There wasn't snowmen. Shot on green screen. There's tracking marks on there because this was shot after another shoot. The tracking marks weren't used for this, for that project. They were used for something else. So look at those nice square tracking marks. So shot on green screen, and then, I don't know, maybe this will answer the question, but then the world was built, the background and the foreground. Then the, I guess really only the pizza character had to be rendered out separately because it is a foreground element that's laying on top of me, the green screen element, right? And those things were recomposited back in After Effects together. So then the background could all be, you know, background video. Does that make sense? But I could also bring in projects like this in After Effects and like show you the breakdown of the layers and stuff too, if that's instructive. Although I always get scared opening up those projects because they're very disorganized and what made sense at the time doesn't make sense anymore. This is completely stills. We've looked at this before, I think, in this class. These are just stills. There's a little puppet warp effect happening to her that's just done in After Effects. But you have to shoot video. It's kind of like a long, high-quality animated GIF sort of thing. I've seen this one too. Also, still. Setups. This was really low budget setup. And she was actually shot on black because there was just way too much green screen spill happening. And these were stills, so I wasn't worried about having to key out a rotoscope video. It was just one frame, so I was just gonna cut it out manually in Photoshop. That's what I did. It's just a scene from Unreal stretched out. This is a fun little one.
Posse!
It's the most difficult shoot I ever did with in my life. These are two of my children. They're big time divas on set. Scenes on that. I guess I don't have it. Thought I did. But yeah, just shot on green screen. Here's another one. This looks really complicated. It's a neat shot, but it's not. It's on green screen. She's standing on a spinner. Turntable. So when the camera looks like it's actually going around her in the tower. In reality, the camera that filmed her just stayed fixed, and I don't know if you could tell, but I was really unhappy at this point in the shoot. So they were not listening. Gotta suffer for your art, I guess. Yeah, but that camera didn't move at all. But from that green screen footage, you got all of this camera movement. Because the rotation of her is just timed to the camera movement rotating around the tower and Unreal. I think it works. I think if I was to do this again, Turned out all right. Happy with it. Boom. Here's the behind the scenes footage of this Diplo Charlie XCX video that did. I don't know if I told you, but I actually did all the visual effects on this myself in about 3.5-4 weeks for a 3-minute-long video. But here's a breakdown of the green screen footage turning into, actually the storyboards turning into the green screen footage turning into the final. Also, no camera movement here. That was a giant fake rock on a turntable there, which was really cool. A giant turntable. In order to do the same sort of effect there. The budget on this wasn't that huge, so gotta be clever about things sometimes. Walking on a treadmill. Is also just done in post. There's no camera movement on set for that project. It's another music video. There is some camera movement in this shoot. You'll see the tracking marks. Pretty happy with this composite right here. Just like putting her hands into some like alien jam of some sort. So that's on the green screen. They're just like these little water beads that you can buy and play with kids. And it was important to have that be tangible because she was actually, you know, grabbing onto them and stuff. And anytime that you want somebody to pick something up or grab onto it or interact with it, it's usually going to look bad if it's completely fake. So if somebody's holding something, if it can be a live action prop, it's going to turn out so much better. But everything else then gets cut away. The frame of the bin that those balls are in gets stripped away. That turned out pretty well. Happy to answer any questions technically too while going through these. Or also happy to just talk about camera tracking. So camera tracking. Tracking can be done on green screen or in the real world, inside this room, out on the street, wherever. Tracking on green screen is more difficult because we need to artificially create tracking marks. The real world, like this room, creates its own tracking marks. Marks on the wall, the ground, the carpet, the texture in the carpet, all the wires laying on the floor, all of those things could be tracking marks. But you sometimes might want to artificially introduce tracking marks into a scene as well. So there are a couple, quite a few actually, different types of tracking softwares. We will be using After Effects because it's essentially free. It is not the best 3D camera tracking software at all, but it does a pretty good job most of the time. Almost all of you said you had never used it before. This is basically what it looks like. You click the button, it scrubs through your footage, trying to find trackable marks and surfaces, and then it spits out something like this. All of these little colorful X's are a feature that it's tracking in the scene. And that big red bullseye shape, you can see that it is aligned in perspective on the ground, on these bricks. So that's good, that's what we want. It would be bad if that surface of that bullseye did not look like it was laying on the ground right there. And that's how we can define what's called a ground plane. You can also do camera tracking in 3D softwares. Cinema 4D, Blender, Nuke, Fusion. If you're familiar with those softwares, you could try doing it in there. I'm not super familiar with doing camera tracking in C4D or Blender, but they might do a better job than After Effects. After Effects kind of is it's a black box when it tracks. You don't really have a lot of manual control over things. These softwares cost quite a bit of money. There's a really great one that I use. It's made by Vicon, a company that makes these really fancy, expensive motion capture cameras called Buju. And it is very manual, if you want it to be. You go in manually, you can pick the features that you want to be tracked. And then you scrub the footage a little bit forward, make sure that they're still tracking. It can be incredibly tedious. About as tedious as rotoscoping. So if you love that sort of work, you'd love this. I can show you Buju if you want it, but you're not gonna learn it unless you learn it by yourself. You can also use Mocha Pro. Mocha Pro is a fantastic tracking software, but it's not cheap. There is a version of Mocha that comes with After Effects, but it is the light version of Mocha, just like After Effects also comes with a light version of C4D, but it's not fully featured. The downside of Mocha AE is that there's no 3D camera solving, which is what we need to do the tracking. There's also PF Track, which is really good. Synthize is probably the most affordable of the more professional tracking softwares. I think it's like $300 or something like that last time I checked. But yeah, not free like After Effects. But Mocha Pro, I think, is like $2,500. I think Buju is like $5,000-$10,000 or something like that. A lot. So a lot of different options, but we'll most likely be using After Effects. Now, all of this happens to do what's called match moving. And I think one of our very first classes, we talked about match moving. Looking forward to today's class. And match moving is that technique that allows us to insert computer graphics into video footage and have the CGI stick to the video. If we wanted to put, you know, a giant dinosaur in this room, in a giant 3D dinosaur in this room, and the camera was moving around, we would have to camera track this room and then insert the 3D graphic in Unreal or in really any 3D platform. You know, in this class we use Unreal because it's a really fast way to build beautiful looking worlds. The techniques of camera tracking are completely applicable to traditional 3D pipelines as well. So the stuff that we learned with camera tracking in here today and in future classes, you could take that knowledge and apply it to traditional 3D rendering with C4D, Blender, Maya, whatever. It's the same idea. It's just in our case, we're taking the 3D camera into Unreal, which is actually another step. So, you know, if you're more interested in just sticking with C4D, then you could do the camera tracking in C4D and also the modeling and the compositing even and everything there. Any questions as I continue through this? Yeah. You want to take video footage into Maya and track it there?
No, I'm saying like what if you want to put like an animated part to Unreal,
but that animated part was rendered out in Maya, and the camera movements are done in there. So we saw that's what the camera. Well, you wouldn't have to solve if you already created a 3D camera. You don't have to solve that. You could export a 3D camera from Maya into Unreal. There's some people that like to, I guess, more like tradition. Maybe they're less familiar with Unreal, so you know they've been working in C4D or Maya forever, and you know they're just more comfortable animating a camera in there. Maybe they built an enormous city, right? And there's like a camera fly through and a chase scene, a car chase, or something like that, as an example. And they could export not just that world, but they could export the camera itself, animated in C4D or Maya, export that to Unreal, import it into Sequencer. And you would have all of that there. At the end of the day, it's just a 3D file that has camera information in it. Whether you're opening that in Unreal or traditional 3D software, it doesn't really matter. It's kind of the same thing. Any other questions? I like this picture a lot. 3D model of this weird transformer character, right? They want to put that into this video footage of this dirt road. So how do we composite that together? You also might want to think about creating 3D dirt road to kind of blend it together, right? When this character puts its foot down, if the world has a little bit of high areas and low areas, it will cover up that character's foot as a little foreground element and make them feel like they're more into it. If we didn't create a ground here and we just slapped it on top of the background, well, the perspective would be okay, but there would be no sort of like areas covering up their feet or anything like that to make them feel like they're actually more immersed in it. At the end of the day, it depends really what exactly the scene is, but I want you to start to think about these sorts of ideas. About putting 3D graphics into video, not just the character, but also world extensions to it. Whether that's a piece of ground or, I don't know, some foliage comes in the foreground or something like that, or maybe there's trees that come in front. Those could be 3D. This is an old piece of software called Autodesk Match Mover. It's the same basic idea of any sort of tracking software. See, it latches onto these features. This looks like it's on some New York City street. And as this camera moves around, you can see the trails from the features. So the feature stays in place, but it moves, so it creates these green lines to it. If you get enough of these features tracked, then you can solve for the camera. Because the goal here is to stick 3D objects onto the environment. If this was a video and I could play it right now, these inverted cones should stick to the corner pieces of this, I don't know, what is this? Like skate park or something? Or some sort of, it's not supposed to be a skate park, but looks like it. But these graphics should stick to the surfaces of the video if it's been a successful camera track. If they're floating around and stuff, then you shouldn't continue. You should try again, or maybe your footage isn't something wrong with your footage. Maybe there's too much motion blur, it's too low resolution. Most likely you just didn't have the right settings when you track the camera. But once you can put simple graphics like this into a scene and have them look like they stick, then anything you put in the scene is going to look good. But yeah, taking a poorly tracked camera through the entire pipeline all the way to Unreal, it's not going to get better. You know, it's not, once you bring it into Unreal, it's not magically going to get better. It's just a kind of a waste of time if it's not looking good to start with. And you'll see today what looks good and what doesn't. So here's this guy standing on this cube here and on green screen. Start to introduce these architectural elements here. There's like this arch. All of these shapes are just locking onto the tracking marks that are on the green screen. You can notice they're just dots, squares. This is a breakdown of a traditional VFX pipeline. Someone being a match mover, it's like an actual position in a VFX film. This person's the match mover. It's their job to do the camera tracking and take 3D models that the animators, 3D models that the modelers and animators made, track the camera, take them, give them to the compositor, combine them all together into the final footage. Because footage starts out in VFX, footage is kind of two things. It's the original video footage that was shot of the talent, right? The people. Because we're not 3D models. And then there's the 3D elements, the VFX. The match mover bridges those two worlds and makes them all work together. This is a really funny video. This is my first ever match moves. Very old. Very exciting water bottle on putting a hole in the wall to make in a large world. This actually became the idea for a shoot over here, but this was the first initial test. Putting a hole in the wall, kind of extruding through the wall to make it look like there's this knockout of the wall and there's a world back there in the background. And the other one's these little robot dudes attacking my wife. So think of match moving as taking footage of the real world. The real world's 3D. But when it's photographed or filmed, that 3D world that we live in is converted into two dimensions, right? It becomes 2D video footage. The match mover's job is to take that 2D footage and extract the 3D camera information from it. After you've done that, then you can insert 3D graphics, like this muscle car here. So see the video footage kind of moves and the 3D graphic is in front of the video footage. When it's all combined together with shadows and stuff and lighting, it kind of works. This is the process that any sort of VFX in any film that you've ever seen, this is how it works. How many people have ever done photogrammetry before? 3D scanning, take a bunch of pictures, it makes a 3D model. Match moving is a similar process in a way, in that photogrammetry is trying to identify similar features between photographs. And it's from that information that it's able to take those photographs and assemble them together and create a 3D model from that depth information. Match moving is doing a similar sort of thing. It's also looking for features. And it's, instead of trying to extract a 3D model of, say, this guitar, or the room, it's trying to extract a 3D model of where the camera existed in 3D space when it shot that scene as it moved around the room. So what the software is doing when it tracks, whether it's After Effects or some other fancy software, is it's identifying features. If we identify one feature, We don't really know much about where that camera is in 3D space. We know it's looking at this edge of this guitar, but it could be out the window. It could be over here. It could be over here. We don't know where in 3D space this camera's located. But as we start to track more points, like say in this case, the camera software or the 3D camera tracker software identified the two corners of this piano bench. By identifying two points to track, and again, this all happens in the software. This is not really something that you have to manually do yourself. I'm just kind of explaining what's happening on the back end. And this is true for photogrammetry too. Once you identify two points, we've locked the rotational axis of the camera. It can't twist anymore, right? Because then those points would be askew. The camera could go up, camera could go down, because those points will still stay parallel to each other. But we're starting to eliminate and lock that 3D camera in space, which is what we need to do to solve for the camera. If we introduce a third feature to track, at the corner of the music up here, now all the rotational axes of this camera are fixed. It can't rotate. It can't rotate on its pitch. It can't rotate on its yaw or its roll. It's frozen. We still don't know where it's at in 3D space, though. We know its rotational values, but we don't know its XYZ values. Anybody have an idea how we solve for that? Or how the software solves for that? With photogrammetry, you shoot a lot of pictures, right? So it's comparing the change between those photos. In the case of photogrammetry, you take two pictures from different angles, you get the depth information of that feature from that angle, you get the depth information of that feature from that angle, and that information is what allows the software to recreate the 3D model in terms of photogrammetry. In terms of camera solving, it allows us to start to begin to extract that camera's position in 3D space. As the camera moves around a scene, we get all that information. And eventually we'll get spit back a little graph or a 3D graph of where our camera is, which is pretty cool. Parallax is very important to us to do 3D camera tracking too. For those of you that have done photogrammetry before, maybe you learned this by mistake, or maybe you were told this, but if I was to 3D scan this room, at least using photogrammetry techniques, depth cameras and other things are different. I'm talking strictly about photogrammetry. If I wanted to scan this room, I wouldn't want to just stay in one spot and take pictures like this. I would want to move around, shift my parallax so that the camera, so that I get different perspectives of the room. So I get the TV from over there, so I get the TV from over here. Not TV there, TV there, TV there. That's not enough movement. A similar sort of problem happens with camera tracking. Maybe some of you did this when you were shooting on the tripod. Just tilting the camera is rarely enough camera information to be able to do a track. If you move the camera, though, on the dolly or by hand or on a stabilizer or whatever, that gives us a lot of information to work with. Because if we're just rotating the pitch of the camera, we're not getting that parallax. If we do all that stuff, we can hopefully solve our camera. And once we solve our camera, now we can send the camera to our 3D software, Maya or Cinema, export that camera to Unreal, build our world in 3D, export that stuff back to After Effects, and do a final composite. And be real proud, because it's a complicated pipeline. I don't want to scare you, but I will say that historically in this class, and this is like the fifth time this class is run, this match motion pipeline usually takes about 4 weeks, good chunk of a semester. Because of the LED wall, we are condensing it into 2 weeks. That's why I say that the next couple classes are going to be the most intense. This is where everybody gets scared and decides, I don't want to move the camera anymore because it's a pain in the ass. If you like to geek out about this sort of stuff, I may have mentioned this before. I think some of you already got this book. You're not required to. But this is a really great book talking about a match moving, the history of it. That's actually the final scene of that guy standing on, we looked at that example up there earlier. Pro tip, you can look at most of the good stuff just by using the Amazon preview. You click it, you get a preview of the book. Otherwise, I think it's like $30. So what's guaranteed to happen for all of you at some point is you will see the dreaded 3D camera tracker fails to solve. It's usually like a big red text thing. So when this happens, there's a couple different reasons why it would happen. You don't have enough parallax. Doing a little camera movement or a lot of camera movement, there's really no difference in terms of like the tracking software. Little camera movement is actually more difficult for the camera software to track. I mean, aesthetically, you need to decide what works for your film and your shot, but technically, there's no difference. So this is what this scene on green screen looks like in 3D when it's extracted. These points right here that are on the grid correspond to the points that are on the floor. The points that are up here are the ones on the wall. Some of these, especially if they're moving, are going to be your talent walking through the scene. So from this two-dimensional video, we get the 3D camera. This is what we want. That's the goal. In After Effects, we don't really ever see this scene because it's kind of hidden from us. So After Effects doesn't want to scare anybody. But if you use like a real 3D tracking software, you will see a 3D view of it. So in After Effects, when a camera fails to solve, it's going to look like this. So a lot of different reasons why this might happen. In this case, footage looks really motion blurred. Motion blur, difficult for green screen keying, also difficult for software to be able to track. Because the features just get lost. They just kind of get mushed together. So try not to have a lot of motion blur. Use higher shutter speed or a better shutter angle. Don't do whip pans or anything like that. You can do those things, you just gotta be clever and try to hide the errors. Other reasons that this might happen. Maybe there is someone in the foreground that's moving around a lot. Maybe you're not seeing a lot of the background. Maybe there's too much motion blur. In this case of this guy here, if we sent this footage to After Effects doesn't know that this is a dude standing in front of a scene that you want to track. It's just treating it all as footage and tracking what you show it. The things that we're tracking shouldn't move themselves. So if this guy is talking to the camera, moving his arms maybe, and even like moves out of the scene, that can cause your camera solve to fail. So what do? You want to have people in your scene, right? Because you're not just going to film a blank green screen. Or maybe you would film the cityscape if you wanted to put Godzilla in it or something. But if you wanted to keep your talent in there, one of the things that you could do, anybody have any ideas? essentially we just hide the person from the camera check. How would we do that with After Effects? Mask them. Which can be a real pain in the butt, right? Especially if they take up huge portions of the scene. So if you have a scene that is giving you the dreaded failed, maybe it's for one of those reasons. Maybe you might have to mask it out. This is where students get pissed off and just move on from footage that they liked before because it's just not working out for them. Other reasons. Talked about camera movements too fast. Talked about moving foreground elements. The middle one briefly mentioned. Not enough depth information because you're doing a tripod pan. When you do a tripod pan, the sensor on the camera is essentially staying in the same XYZ position. You need to move that camera. There is a way to solve for tripod solves in 3D camera tracking softwares, but you usually need to click the drop-down menu and say, this is a tripod pan. Not traditional camera movement. Now, that might all seem really scary and stuff, but think, not every single shot needs camera movement, right? You think, go back and watch a film and think, how many scenes is the camera moving? Is it moving in every scene? Is it more dramatic in some than others? Are there some where the camera's locked off? Films are usually built up unless kind of the premise of the film is camera movement. Films are built up of lots of different types of shots, right? Tracking the camera is one tool to use to make a larger film. So don't freak out too much about the difficulty of this stuff. I'm gonna shift gears a little bit. Any questions so far? Sure, there'll be questions when we start to do it. Tracking marks. Now, I didn't give a lot of guidance on this last week because I wanted to see what would happen. I think a lot of people did things right. There is no wrong way to do tracking marks as long as you have something on the background. The problem that you can run into with tracking marks is that you go overboard. The tracking software is not going to mind. The tracking software will do a great job. The thing that's going to mind is you when you have to remove those tracking marks, right? If you go and shoot on green screen, the whole point of shooting on green screen is to take the background away. If we go and fill that green screen with a bunch of these shapes on the background, or even black dots, well, congratulations, you tracked your camera, but now you have to remove those black dots, which can be equally difficult. Sometimes it's just a necessary evil. Gotta track my camera. I really need to do it like this for some reason. Other ways to do it aren't working out. Maybe I use green tracking marks, it's not working out. Maybe I have to use more distinct tracking marks. And yes, you just have to suck it up and rotoscope them out, paint them out, perhaps frame by frame. So there is no wrong way to do it. I can just give you suggestions on what to do instead. Be much better to use a tracking mark that is greenish or even bluish, because you could also key that out, right? Ideally, we would want to find a tracking mark that is able to be distinguished by the camera tracking software, so it has enough contrast to stand out, but not so much contrast that we can't easily key it out. Now, for tracking marks that go behind a person, it's always going to be some level of finesse that you have to do, either with rotoscoping or more advanced keying, but it just comes with the territory. So my suggestion is not to use orange tape on a green screen.
Also, because this orangish reddish color is like close to skin tones, you know, in computer software. Also, I would not suggest to make X's. I would suggest to make dots like this. Even these are like really obnoxious and unnecessary, unless you need them for some other sort of technical reason, shooting stereoscopic 3D or something like that. But an X, this actually has one, two, actually any little point here could be a tracking mark if you thought about it. But in reality, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
12 corners that are great features to track, like hard edges, right?
Yeah, you could probably track some of the wrinkles or the rips if you really wanted to, like that point right there. But it's not as harsh as the edges of the tape where it meets the green screen. I think this is overboard. And it's also rather large, so my suggestion is not to shoot with X's.
Use dots. I prefer using squares, because squares at least give you, so I don't have a good example of it right here, but squares give you,
squares give you at least four corners on each tracking mark.
So using dots or squares, I think that's preferable. How many do you need on screen at any one given time? Somebody asked this last week, but I'll mention it again. Ideally, wherever you point your camera, you want 9 tracking marks to fill the frame. If you put all your tracking marks right here behind my head, and then I move over here, and the camera moves too, well then how many are still behind me? How many are still in camera? You need to track for the duration of your shot. So however long your shot is, you need to be tracking for that amount of time, which means wherever the camera points, you need to be able to see tracking marks. They don't need to be the same tracking marks. They just need to be a tracking mark. I would say 9 is the bare minimum. Some softwares do better than others at locking on to markers. After Effects does an okay job. Okay, not great, but usually good enough. After Effects 3D Camera Tracker is really good at tracking outdoor scenes. Green screen scenes, okay. I mentioned this before.
Move the camera if that's what you want to do. This sentence right here, we only move the camera a little to make it easier to track, is not really an answer.
Remember I said that moving the camera a little is the same as moving it a lot. The software doesn't really care. Actually, it prefers more camera movement.
So in this case, moving the camera a little not only made for a boring shot, you might as well not have moved it at all, but it doesn't make the shot any easier to track. Big moves, little moves, makes no difference.
What does make a move difference is fast moves, because motion blur can screw things up.
You could also be fancy. You could use, you could artificially make tracking marks with a projector too, if you wanted to.
Shine dots at your green screen.
You can also, this is a little bit more advanced, but in
on green screen last week, I asked you to shoot full body, preferably. Because on green screen, if you don't have a floor, it can be much more difficult to track because there's just one plane. With a floor, we have two planes, right? Which makes it easier for the camera to be solved in software. A way to get around that is to artificially place tracking marks in the foreground.
So if you're shooting somebody on green screen and you have a shot of them that is just not full body, right, it's cropped at my waist, I have tracking marks on the green screen. In order to possibly get a better track, or not just for half body shots, but you could introduce artificial tracking marks, like put a light stand here with a tracking mark on it. As long as it doesn't block your character, your talent, that's okay. because what that gives you as the camera moves around is a parallax, because there's a tracking mark here and a tracking mark back there that causes that parallax shift between them. It's that parallax that allows us to solve for the camera. I'll try to find a picture for you before during the break to demonstrate that. Yeah, crazy shapes, not really useful unless you're shooting really fast whip pans and stuff. So these are my suggestions for tracking marks on green screens. Questions? Who used black tracking marks? Nobody. Good, because we got that green tape. The green tape, that the green gaff tape out there works really well. That's what I usually use. No questions? All right, let me show you what we're going to work with, and then we'll take a break. Actually, you know what? Let's just take a break now. Come back at 3:30. Oh, before you leave, make sure you download those files if you didn't already. Okay? It's about 600 megabytes, I think. Somebody remind me to unpause. We're live. All right. So I gave you, let me just delete this real quick. I gave you a bunch of stuff to download. In my AE tracking zip folder. Lots of things here. Some test images to use. I like to use grids because they'll show you that things are sticking with the markers, as you'll see when we track. I have some other videos. Oh no, why can't I not look at this? That's strange. Well, we'll look at it in After Effects then. Handheld camera, don't tell anybody, it was shot with a phone. I know, controversial. A little bit of motion blur. Look, see how some shots are a little blurred than others? That one. That one. But we can stick things to the ground, and we'll do that. I have this scene. In the garden. I'll show you what this turned into. I have the raw footage of that woman standing on green screen that we've seen. It's like a camera on a dolly moving around her. Let me show you this one, what this turned out to be. We'll track it too from the beginning. All right, so this footage we just saw, little girl standing in garden. It's actually not the footage that we use, but it's a larger take. Lots of camera movement, handheld camera. That was tracked in After Effects. And start to put 3D graphics on top of it. Google Slides, I hate. It always starts videos and then stops them.
rotoscope her out, then you could put graphics behind her too. You have to rotoscope because she's not shot on green screen, so you can't key her. So her body essentially cut out where that piece of geometry goes behind her. You don't need to cut things out when you're covering them up in the foreground. Eventually, this was turned into a Halloween scene. Put pumpkins in there in Unreal Engine. Oh, see the floating at the end there? That's because the track stopped. This is what you don't want to happen right here. This is good. This is what I mean by floating. Building up the scene more. It's not color graded or anything. Now, problem in this scene, talked briefly about this already, is the dirt in this garden is very uneven, right? There's like big mounds of dirt, some low areas, some high areas. If this heavy pumpkin was actually sitting on the ground, it should be sunken in a little bit, right? But how do we sink it into a video? We can't. So we would actually have to build 3D ground with a material on it that kind of looks like the dirt in the real video, sink the 3D pumpkin into the 3D dirt, and kind of blend the seams all together in composite. Tricky stuff when you have to do everything. This is the more final seam. You know, lighting matters too. Color quality matters. Just depends on how real you want to make things. Camera movement really makes things just seem a lot more realistic, though. You should be able to make something like this very soon. I think that's all of the examples. These slides are on the syllabus if you ever want to refer back to them. Cherish them. All right, let's track a scene. Kind of run through all of these examples, I think. I'm going to track this basic scene to start with. I just imported everything in the folder that I gave you. All right, first things first, we need to make this footage into a composition. So I'm just going to drag it down in my layer window. Now I have it to use. Let's track it. Easiest place to click for tracking the camera. You click tracker on the right side, it will drop down and you'll see all these options. Perhaps you've tracked motion on objects before or use warp stabilizer in After Effects. We're clicking track camera. If you don't have this menu, you can get it from the window menu up top. It says tracker. Go ahead and click track camera, and it should just start doing its thing if you're following along. Analyzing. We just sit and wait. Eventually, you'll see it start to go through the frames. When I'm zoomed in, it pauses, so it's going to take about 30 seconds to do total. The higher resolution your footage, the longer it is, this takes longer. If you've shot a lot of footage and you only want to track a portion of it, you should only import that portion into After Effects and track it. All right, that finished. Now you should see a bunch of rainbow colored dots all over your footage. And if you move your mouse around, you should see this target that is bouncing around. I'm going to make these points a little bit bigger so we can see them. This is just in the effect for the layer. Track point size. If you ever do a camera track and these points are gigantic, this is where you can change the size of them. you ever do a track and the target is gigantic,
that's where you can change the size of the target.
gigantic markers and the target usually means that something in the extreme foreground is being tracked. And usually it's a something you should be worried about. Not a disaster yet, but usually something bad is possible. All right, I'm going to make my screen a little bit bigger here so you can see. And check out what happens as I move my mouse around. I don't know if you can see with the, see the little white box that's getting created? The white triangle that's getting created? It's essentially drawing a plane between three tracking marks, three features that are being tracked. In this case, you know, two scuffs on the floor and then part of this cabinet over here. Kind of looks like this is the proper perspective of the floor-ish. Essentially what this is it's drawing a plane that should match up with what you want to be your floor. That's what you're trying to do, right? If I select multiples of these, kind of averages out all of them, which can be good sometimes, can be bad sometimes. I personally think like just doing three of these, actually that doesn't look like it's really laying the right direction. Maybe it is, but my eyes aren't noticing it, but I don't think so. I tend to find selecting more is beneficial. That looks much better in my opinion. You know, if I wanted to track this for some reason, now I've put the plane on the surface of that toolbox there, right? If I selected, I think I can do this, but if I selected that point and then went up there and grabbed that one, I'm gonna get a weird marker. It's just gonna be like floating. It somehow drew a plane that's floating in space. This is not that useful for me. I just selected all this stuff. That's not very useful for me. This is though. Right like that. Let me get out of full screen mode. So when the points that you select is really up to you. It's a trial and error thing. This looks good though. You want your target to look like it's sitting on the floor. And again, here you could adjust the size of it to get a better feel for things. As soon as you move your footage, it disappears though. So you're doing this a little bit in a vacuum. Also, notice how the points change when I move. It's because some of the ones in the back, they get too far away, they get too blurry, so After Effects just forgets them. I'm tracking the chair a lot here too now. I'm gonna scrub like right here. Find a good position in your film where the important things happen. And I'm gonna select these points right here. That looks pretty good to me. The next step is we gotta right click. Very important, set ground plane and origin. It's not letting me zoom in right now. Set ground plane and origin. What this does is it sets our ground plane, which is going to be the same perspective as this target is right now, going back into infinity, and it's going to make the 000 position right in the middle of the target in our world. So set ground plane and origin. Students always forget to do that. Don't forget. Next thing, right click again on the target, create solid and camera. There's a lot of other options which are valuable in their own right, but I like to show create solid and camera. This is gonna do is it's gonna create. Oh, thank you, After Effects, for giving me the tutorial. I'm gonna skip that. It created two things here. It created a 3D camera, and it created a solid, which is just a flat plane. Now if I scrub, that flat plane is now stuck to my floor. Look at that. There's also audio. Would you look at that? It sticks to the floor. Pretty cool. Now the foreground elements are a problem, right? But this is the first step. If I wanted to, you know, if my goal in this project was put purple block on floor, then I'm partially successful. The next step would be to actually like rotoscope out that portion of the chair. So, briefly talked about rotoscoping. If I selected the chair, I'm gonna do just a really quick bad job here. Now I have chair by itself-ish. I don't have the handles on the chair or anything like that, but just for a demo, that then gets laid over top of purple block. My gosh, is this compositing? I think it is. You know, I need to do the pull of the chair and the adjuster thing and all that, but, and it's kind of choppy on the edge, but you know, you can start to see how this comes together, right? In our case, the 3D solid, we're not going to use that in our world, right? Unless everybody's final project is going to be purple square on floor, then we're really nailing it. But this purple block is useful, and I like to keep it with us through this pipeline. Through this pipeline, even into Unreal, because we can screw up throughout the rest of this pipeline, and this block allows me to compare with what looked good in After Effects. It should still look like this when I bring this video into Unreal, and I'll bring this purple solid into Unreal as a 3D model as well, and it should be in the exact same position. And if it's in the exact same position, then I'm good to go, and then I can put actual 3D objects in. So this is kind of my reference to make sure things are stuck to the floor. It's also kind of a great world zero position thing to have too. Now I could actually shrink this block down still if I wanted to, and it would still stay stuck to the floor because I'm not changing the position of it, I'm just changing the scale. I could actually raise it up in the sky too. Oops, I clicked on the roto brush, that's why. Actually, I could move it on the floor too. And it's still tracking. Fine. So I just slid it on that ground plane. I could actually float it in the air too. Now it's not sitting on the ground anymore. Now it's going to look like a little piece of paper floating in the air. Which, if that's the goal, then you did it. The goal was to make it stick to the floor. It no longer sticks to the floor. I'll do that. Actually, if you look in the positional settings for that solid, the Y position, negative 856 something, it's not on the floor. The floor is zero. Floor is zero, so if I change that back to zero, now it's back on the floor. Tricky too, because in After Effects, Y is up, and in Unreal, Z is up. Cool. I feel pretty good about that. My lovely compositing skills here. So at this point, this is where we would move into next steps for this scene. This is where we would bring this into C4D, which is the workflow that I'm going to show you. We used to do it in Maya, but the plugin no longer gets updated. So even though I prefer Maya, I stopped doing that. We have a lot of C4D people, it seems like. So I'm going to show you in C4D. But that is a demo for next week. I'm going to show you in some other scenes now. Any questions about this black screen? I have questions about the black screen. But we're just going to roll with it for the next
57 minutes. Or less than that.
If you could do this, you should feel good. Question. Oh. The fancy part, but the non-crucial part to camera checking. I mean, it is in the sense that you want your foreground elements to be on top of it. So yeah, I guess it is crucial. But like if, sorry, I didn't mean it like that. Like this example here, oh, actually, these examples of the pumpkins themselves don't matter because they're foreground elements, right? They're just slapped on top of her. But anytime you put something behind her, like all that fake pumpkin leaves and stuff, that needs to be cut out. So you're entirely right. I should show you that. So let's, I already deleted it. Let's do it from scratch. So all I did was take the original picture, put it on top so it covers up everything. And then I got the roto brush. Roto brush is this little person with the paintbrush poking at them. To use the roto brush, you need to double click on the layer and go into the layer tab rather than the composition tab. Now you have a little green circle here. If I hold down Alt, it turns red. So I basically paint the things that I want to mask out. So in my case, paint the chair. You can go into brushes and you can change the size of things. Oops. But this is good enough for now. What happened? So if you hit the play button, then see, it puts a pink line around it. In reality, using the roto brush is not this simple. It's actually really excruciating and painful. So you usually have to pause at every frame and adjust, paint, adjust, paint, adjust. But for this example, just really quickly did that. So now if I go back to the composition tab, or actually I could even look at these down here, these three little people walking there. I click this, it just shows me a mask of it. If I click this, it shows me a quick mask. If I go back to the composition tab up top, and it puts it all together, ooh, got moved. Oh. So this layer got moved. Whoopsies. So now this chair is by itself. It's a foreground element now, just laying on top of my video. So you bring in the purple solid, and then you bring in a background. Ta-da. This is really only useful if you're doing real world stuff. If you're doing green screen, don't really need to rotoscope most of the time. Unless it's a bad green screen or you need to get rid of your tracking marks. Other questions about this? What we just did here is the same thing that you do for every shot. Minus that, the rotoscoping. All right, let's do another one. Why don't we do the one on green screen? So I'm going to create a new composition of this. Play it back. Really smooth camera dolly here. Lots of green tracking marks on the floor. Striking a pose. Looks good. So we're going to do the same thing. We're gonna go to tracker, track camera. Just click it, let it run through it. So there are some other options in the 3D camera tracker.
There's not a lot of options in After Effects. In other softwares, there's a lot more features to change. Notice how this says shot type, fixed angle of view. If you have zoom shots, there's this drop down that changes that you can set variable angle of view. You can also set tripod shot. You'll have limited success, but you need to set those if you have those types of shots.
My suggestion is to just do proper shots. Actually, this is not even this drop down just says, it's not letting me zoom in for some reason.
It says variable zoom.
If you click on the advanced tab, strange, I can't zoom in when I have a menu open. If I click on the solve method, I can change it from a typical, mostly flat scene if you have no floor,
or a tripod pan if it's on a tripod.
You have varying success with these, but this is about as advanced as After Effects Camera Tracker gets. Good to know, though, especially if things aren't working out for you. All right, what happened? Did this finish or no? I think it finished. It's just my points are really tiny. So I'm gonna increase the size of them. Can I put a bigger number? Oh yeah, there we go. Notice how on some of these points, there's multiple markers. Because it's tracking the corners of, they did X's. So the green screen starts to swoop up here in the background, so these points right here aren't very useful. The ones on the floor here are. But you gotta be careful because I might select points that are actually her feet, which are not flat on the floor. They are feet, so they're bent, right? So scrub the scene and find points that work. So I'm gonna lasso around her feet here. I'm gonna select like that. I think that's good. Left click, hold, lasso them, lasso,
and let go.
That looks pretty good to me. Yeah, adjust the target size, blow it up a little bit. Yeah, that looks like the floor. Cool. Next step, right click, set ground plane and origin. Right click again, create solid and camera. Scrub, does it look good? I think it looks beautiful. I could, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm actually gonna replace this. I'm gonna scale up this ground plane. Maybe I'll just rotate it so it's more in the shape of like the room. I'm not moving it. I'm not moving it up. I'm not moving it around the ground plane. I just rotated it. Still at zero position. Ground plane, the position of the solid is still 0, 0, 0. But sometimes I like to go in and put grids on things or checkerboards. There's a little After Effects trick here. This is not camera tracking specific, but if you ever want to replace one layer, like a blue solid, or anything really, it doesn't matter. I want to replace the blue solid with this checkerboard JPEG. If I select the layer I want to replace, in this case the solid, and I hold down Alt, and I drag the thing I want to replace it with on top of it while holding Alt, and I let go, boop, swaps it out. Maybe I'll enlarge it. Maybe I'll turn down the opacity a little bit. It's kind of a cool reference test image to help you really feel good about that track. There's some very slight drift, but I think it's pretty negligible. Yeah, that could help. You're so limited with After Effects that you're just gonna have to suck it up a little bit at the end of the day. With the more advanced softwares, you literally can go in and say, that's my tracking mark, and then you track it for the duration. It's very excruciatingly time consuming, but at least then you only have yourself to blame rather than the mystical track camera button that just does it automatically. Yeah.
I mean, I know this probably varies by case, but like, let's say you're getting like jitter or something with your tracking points, and in addition to four points that you've marked, like if you added a wall, the wall marks, would that help? Or is that like, I'm surprised how many few trackers are using this process.
Oh, you are.
I guess it makes sense. You don't need necessarily more.
You only need 3 points to solve for the camera's rotation and position. It's all coming together now, right? It just came together for me too. I was like, oh yeah, that's the reason I put those graphics there. Good question. But yeah, it's just a triangle, right, at the end of the day, between those points. Introducing the wall is problematic because it's not the way that After Effects works. We're defining a ground plane, it's gonna skew our ground plane. So that's not, if we skew our ground plane, then we don't know where the ground is. You could guess, but that's practically impossible. Like with my checkerboard now, I look at its position, you know, After Effects is telling me it's on the floor because it's 0, 0, 0. I notice a little bit of drift with this point here. But it's not that bad. It's not on the line anymore, but over here it's on the line. See that? Devastating. If you want to be really particular about it, you can go crazy and you could blow up your floor like this, and then you could get your pen tool and put a mask on each of the marks. And then really see if it moves. Had a little bit of drift on this one. See, it was in the middle, and now it's not. Here it's in the middle, and it kind of stays. A little bit. Is it good enough? It really depends on what you're trying to do. Does anybody notice? That's really all that matters. It doesn't have to be perfect if it's good enough. But a lot of times, just with After Effects, is what we have to settle for, especially on green screen because there's limited tracking marks. We could try other ones. Might be good enough, might be better. It'd be a real trial and error thing, though. Other fun things that we could do. I could build a 3D world out of this in After Effects. What if I duplicated this checkerboard and then I dragged this one over here and then I rotated it like a wall and then I moved it up? Start to create like a little house for her to be in. It's like After Effects is the 3D world building software. When I duplicate this one too, this is not something you have to do. I'm just kind of showing you how it is 3D now. Where is my, not my grid, my test screen? Need something that is more solid. Crank up the opacity, scale it down. I'm gonna create just a little box for her to live in. Scale this down again. This. Check this. Rotate this. Move it forward. I know I'm doing this really quick, but it's kind of just to show a point. I'm just rotating things and duplicating things. Now she's in a little house. Or we could float this one up and then put a little peekaboo window in here. Oops. Hello. I'm very proud of this one. That's pretty fun though. Now imagine these flat planes as 3D geometry in Unreal. Same thing. It's just these are lame 3D planes. I think they're pretty cool. But this is match motion right here. We have created, we have inserted computer graphics into her world. Messes up at the end there because she's not rotoscoped out. She should be rotoscoped, so this graphic then becomes behind her, right? So we would need to cut her out of the green screen and then place it so she's there. It gets a little tricky because then you want this part of her body to be in front of this, but behind this, right? So the layering can get a little bit more complicated. Or even like the checkerboard floor. If we wanted her to stand on a checkerboard floor, I'm going to need to rotoscope out her feet, definitely, but also her legs, because it goes back up to her legs. Oh, maybe we should do that. Any questions? I'm also just kind of freestyling, so by no means are you interrupting. Interrupt. Yeah. Good point. So well, Resolve introduces another piece of the pipeline that I didn't account for. But I guess I talk so much crap about keying in After Effects, I should deserve it. After Effects is our 3D camera tracker in this case, right? So I'm not going to talk about tracking in Resolve. It can be done, but I'm not terribly comfortable teaching it, so I'm just not. So you can do your tracking in After Effects, and that is completely independent of the key. It doesn't matter where you key, because that camera that we're tracking in After Effects is going to become a 3D camera. It has nothing to do with the footage, right? So I think to answer your question is do the tracking in After Effects. If you want to do the keying in Resolve, that's absolutely fine, because it's the same video, right? The key has nothing to do with the camera track, and the camera track has nothing to do with the key. But when they're lined up together, success. And then once we do our camera track like we've just done, the next step is for us to export this to
Cinema or Maya, which we will do next week, and then import into Unreal. Next week is going to be a real banger of a class. It's going to be insane. Intense. But good. But you got to start with a good camera track. All this stuff that we're, silly stuff that we're doing with the planes right now, you don't have to do this at all. This is just to show for demonstration purposes, like, or to help you understand this is a good camera track and nothing's floating around. Actually looks more believable with the things floating around her than it does when it was on the floor, I think. You can get away with that a little bit more than when it's on the floor. Actually, I thought about this today, and it's semi-related. The busier the scene is, the more you can get away with a not-so-great camera track. I thought about this in a similar context with the LED wall in the room. I was trying to start to build our pipeline in there this morning, and I just had like the test Unreal, the default map, right? Which is just like the sky and the ground. And when you look at the LED wall with just the gradient sky, it's not so impressive. You can see like the individual panels of the screen, but when the scene's very busy, you don't see that anymore. Similar sort of idea here. When the scene's more busy, our eyes don't focus on how crappy a job you did tracking the camera. So do a good job tracking the camera, but also don't freak out too much. It's not perfect. No. You could, if you didn't want to do anything with Unreal, you could just stop at
this step right here. And your traditional 3D modeler, Cinema 4D, going to click and render for 14 hours. You can just stop right there.
The only reason we go into Unreal is because people don't have concrete 3D modeling skills in this class. And also, we don't want to have time to render. That's why we're... Yep. In Unreal Engine, with this example here,
this video footage is brought into Unreal Engine just like we did in class. These elements, this video footage is attached to a camera. In Unreal Engine, y'all are just wanting to do next week's class already. That's cool. In Unreal Engine, we're going to use something called Composure, which then allows us to place assets in the world and designate them as foreground or background pieces. So we bring the video footage into Unreal, and we build the world around the footage, just like we've been doing, but now it's tracked camera. If you're not doing camera movement, then this class today is not important. But yeah, the stuff that we do next week with the compositing in Unreal is still important, but the camera tracking is not if you're not moving the camera. But you should move the camera because it's fun.
Let's say that you go back to After Effects. And like this footage, like maybe there's just like a bump in it in the camera footage. Could you like stabilize it first? I don't know. Like, let's just say like for some reason something goes wrong on set. You have this footage of work with it, and it's not stable enough. Can you fix that before it happens?
You could smooth the camera movement, yes, but there's a problem with that. So once we export this as a 3D camera, we just see keyframes in a timeline of the XYZ and rotational positions of the camera, right? It just becomes like the cameras that we made in Unreal are the same thing, right? Except it's this one, it's just its position is determined by the movement in the real world. You could delete keyframes that are problematic. If you look at the graph and you see a spike where there's a bad one, you could just kill that one. Then your camera's gonna be smooth. But there's a reason that that camera spiked like that. It's because footage also jittered, right? So if you eliminate that problem in the footage is still gonna be fucked up, you know? So, I don't know, maybe you could like splice the footage in some way to kind of conceal that. You'd have to,
But yeah, you could just delete the keyframes to get rid of bad ones. I've done that before where the track is a little jittery and I'll smooth it and you can't really tell with the footage. It's like good enough. But if you start to delete too many keyframes, then it starts to separate, you know? Just like with motion capture, right? Like the reason we record motion capture is for all that fidelity. If we go in and we start deleting keyframes, then why do motion capture? If we start deleting keyframes in the tracked camera, why track the camera? Good question. I could look at this all day. What was I doing? The key? Yeah, I think we have time to do that. So the key. Maybe I'll create a garbage mask first. I don't think I've ever showed creating a garbage mask. Garbage mask just gets rid of the garbage, right? I can't key out these flags on these lights or this light or this piece of wood at the end here. I can't key that out, so I have to mask it out. It's called a garbage mask. So just literally going in and drawing around the stuff that I want to keep. But I'm going to have to animate this mask. So I'm going to have to keyframe it, the position of it, and the path of it. It doesn't have to be very detailed. Oops. The better the garbage mask, the more results you'll have, but it also takes a lot of time to do. That's good enough. Let me isolate that layer. So now I got rid of the garbage, right? So now I can key it and it should cleanly key. Although she has a lot of spill on her and it's a white jacket, so it's not that easy. Key it out. Status. Whoa, that's not great. That's better. Remember, the white pixels are fully opaque, the gray pixels are semi-translucent, and the black ones are fully translucent. Screen that. I'm just going to be really harsh here in the interest of time. Good enough for now. You should really do your keying in, not in After Effects.
Oh no.
Good enough. Oh wow. She didn't look that green when she wasn't keyed out. She's very green. Advanced spill suppressor. Good enough. Oops. Maybe I'll add a little bit of softness to that key. Good. All right, well now she's on top of everything, right? So now I have to sandwich her between this layer. So I'll put this layer on top of the key. And I also want her behind this one. So I have to put that one on top of her. But I want that one in the background here to go behind her, which I think it already is. So it's just a layer stack, right? Now she's in front of it. I'll even move that one. I'll get cocky with it and move that one behind her more. Oh yeah, look at that. So we didn't have to rotoscope this one because she's on green screen. I had to rotoscope out the other one because it was a real world shot, not on green screen. Silly examples with planes, but this is the premise and the basics of everything that we do with this, whether it's 3D models or not. Any other questions about this? Yeah.
So it aside from exporting the camera data from here next week to CPU or Maya, for AE to Unreal, we would just key this and export it as the XR image sequence.
Just the footage you're talking about?
Yeah.
Independent of the camera.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, absolutely. Same thing that we did before. It's like a house of cards, right? Look, we built this up over the last couple of weeks. It's almost like there's a plan. Almost. Yep. It's all coming together. There was something else that I wanted to slip my mind. Questions? If your track, even though there's a little bit of floatiness, so I think that one plane's not actually on the ground, which is why it's floating. Ooh, did you know that you can go into the four view in After Effects? This is not to scare you, because this isn't really an After Effects 3D class, but over here, if you change the one view to a four view, then you can actually look at the alignment of things. That's a top view. This is a side view. Layers here. Where's my floor? Yeah, so this is the floor. See that line right there that I have selected? That's the floor. And where's that back piece? Oh, there it is. It would help if I named everything, not testscreen.jpg, right? This is why you do that. So where was that floor at? Oh, the floor is the long line here. And so if I wanted it to sit on top of that, I need to put it so it's sitting on the floor. So the bottom of the card is now sitting on the floor. Before it was going through it, which made it look like it was floating. Now it looks like it's on the floor. Cool. Let's just do one more. If your results are like this, you should feel really good about that. Even if there's just minimal floating like I have here, you should feel really good about that. If it's like in that pumpkin video where I showed you at the end where it all starts to slip, that's bad. You should restart what you're doing. All right, let's do one more. Let's do the pumpkin one. New comp. This is ungraded footage, but that's fine. Camera track, tracker, track camera. The busier scenes like this and longer scenes can take a little bit longer to process, but it's fairly quick, about a minute. But this is an interesting shot because the floor is not smooth like the other examples. Both of the other two examples in the hallway of that studio and then on the green screen, the floor was flat, right? The floor is not flat here. So which points are we going to pick? That's a really good question. All right, it tracked. You see she creates a bunch of points as well as the plants in the background. But lots of features here to track. Nobody ever really likes to shoot live action in this class historically. It's always on green screen. Doing it in the real world is a lot easier, just FYI, at least for the camera track. You have to rotoscope and stuff, but at least the tracking is easier because there's stuff to track. All right, so now you can see there's a bunch of markers all on the ground, but this marker is on the top of the grass. This one's on the top of that mound of dirt.
This one's lower down on the ground. This one's on the top of the grass. This one's on the top of the grass. This one's an even taller part of the grass. Like, what if I select these ones? It's angled. Because this point right here is actually higher than these ones.
So how do you choose? So it really depends on what you're doing with it, but to make things simple, I would just average it out and call it a day. That'd be the easy way to do things. If you really needed to be specific, pay more attention to where you're selecting, then yeah, you have to pick points that are more important to what you're doing. I want to set the floor at the lowest point of all these mounds of dirt. Well, I have no idea what that is because I didn't have a tape measure when I filmed this. So you're going to have to guess. It's always going to be a guess at the end of the day. So averaging is just the easiest way for you to do that. But averaging is also what got us into trouble with the last one, which is why we have a little bit of that slipping. Because it's not as precise. Which is why the other softwares can be better. But they're very expensive and nobody really is going to use them. Let's create a target. Same thing. Right click, set ground plane and origin. Right click, create solid and camera. Let me make my points a little bit smaller. Tracked. Camera tracking is easy. You just click the button and right-click a couple times. Going out throughout the whole pipeline and doing something fun with it is the harder part. Because there's all these other things that are involved with it. If you were just the camera tracker, you would just click a couple buttons. But it's that entire pipeline, that's what makes this such a tedious process. Doing the tracking in After Effects, doing the keying in After Effects, sending that to a 3D software to convert it into 3D camera, bring it into Unreal, making sure that you didn't mess up throughout the process and everything is still aligned. It's not a trivial thing to take this footage from here to Unreal and take the red block from here to Unreal and have them match up. Getting all that to match up across the entire pipeline, you should feel really proud that you're able to do that because there's a lot of steps, even though it might not seem that crazy right now. Same thing. This is where I would export the camera and begin. And I'll put the grid back on this. It'd be really cool if somebody that is more well-versed with Cinema or Blender or some other sort of 3D package investigated their built-in solutions for tracking. This pipeline that I've built for class, I think it's just the most accessible, cheapest, and easiest to understand. But by no means is it the best. It's definite limitations. So if there's any people that are more well-versed in 3D and those softwares, that would be great to share with the class.
Grid.
Actually, I have a tracking mat for this too, so I can cut her out really quickly. She's already been cut out with a tracking mat. Where's the grid at though? Does it just want it behind her body, her upper body? It's like we're in Tron now, in the Matrix.
If you wanted to build a scene out of this, I would 3D model a ground to look similar in composition to this ground. Put those pumpkins on there, and then kind of blend the seams together in the final composite. That's down the line. Hooray, camera check. Questions? I'm just blown away by the possibilities, huh? This is gonna let you put visual effects into the real world. Pretty cool. Go and watch like the fancy, what's the Avengers 360 shot? Yeah, the circle shot. With real people shot on green screen, and then, you know, also CGI location and the Hulk and stuff. It's the same thing. It's just we don't have the budget for the Hulk. Start to look at films now a little bit differently, perhaps. You start to go behind the magic. Because now you can create the magic too. Remember the first class, we watched that video from the series Light and Magic. That's what this stuff is. It's gonna make me cry. All right, and on that note, I'm gonna stop the recording.